Squad games right there. Look at him go. You know when,
baby, I can't take it anymore.
Steve, put your headphones on. The song is over.
You and me, baby, head games. Just like a duck, quack. You and me, baby, quack, quack, head games. I can't take it, mother ducker, head games.
Sorry.
Look at him. You can do whatever you want, man. When you're inducted to the Hall of Fame, you get a song.
You
get to have any song played that you want. We play Head Games.
That's
for
the best
great
song.
Steve Poltz.
Dude, that song brings me back.
Well, I was reading you on Facebook the other night, and you were talking about how you played that song, and it was just a fun throwback for you.
Yeah.
It's a great song. It's a great album.
I love that song.
That's Foreigner.
Woo!
Hey, Hall of Famer.
I washed my hair today.
You look good.
Uh-huh.
Feel good.
You look good. You got your...
I brushed it.
You got your brown and gold Padres shirt on.
I do. I figure I'm going
to
bring them luck.
I
was eating some tacos last night like you do when you're in San Diego, bro. And I got out of the water. There was a gnarly south swell coming in. Mm-hmm. Pulled the boards out. I got in the water. I said, Kooks, get out of my way. I'm back in town, bro. And I paddled out and I got so tubed. And then I was eating these tacos, carne asada tacos like you do. And I was watching the pods. And it was the ninth inning and they did not come back. No. I couldn't believe it. They tied the game. And then they lost in the bottom of the ninth. It's like they got snake bit all of a sudden. So we're going to cut the head off of a chicken inside the studio today.
No,
all right.
No.
Live.
I'm down.
No.
You ready?
I'm ready. I'm down.
Let's
whatever it
kill
takes.
Kill a chicken and drink the blood out of the heart of the chicken and change the luck of the Padres today. Normally I wouldn't kill a chicken, but these are desperate times, people.
Steve Poltz has spoken.
All right.
Yes.
Well, all right, buddy. Welcome back to town.
Yours.
I'm high on meth coffee.
Say what?
Stopped at that Starbucks by your place.
How has your life changed, and I hope it's improved, since you were inducted to the DSC Hall of Fame?
It's amazing. I was just inside the Starbucks across the street from here. You know where you guys are located? There's that Starbucks there.
Right.
And I walked inside, and this dude actually was in there, and he goes, "You're Steve Poltz." And I go, "Yeah." He goes, "You're about to be on the radio." I said, "Yeah." He said, "You're in the Hall of Fame." And I go, "I am." And he said, "Put it on my tab." And the guy pulled his thing out,
wow,
his Starbucks app, whoa, and pushed me out of the way and bought my coffee and my tour manager's coffee. So
that's awesome.
Already things are looking up.
It's like your money's no good here, that kind of thing.
Totally. Totally. I went to the Bambi Club in Tijuana and I walked in. They go, "Here's a table for you." It was amazing.
Gee whiz. You are the king.
Things are happening.
Is it true, Steve, that you are going to sing a national anthem at an upcoming sometime in the future Padres game?
Yeah, I just got a text from the guy that sets it up, Chris Modell, and he said, "Hey, when I watched you, I heard you're going to be on DSC, I swear to you." Mm-hmm. I have the text. He goes, "And you're in the Hall of Fame."
Yeah.
"What day do you want to do the anthem?" So as I'm in here, whilst on the air, I'm booking an anthem, and I'm going to go sing that anthem and turn the luck around of
I love
the boys.
It. I think you will. I absolutely believe that. And I also believe that 40,000 people would come out just to see you sing the anthem, and then, oh, their baseball game is going to break out afterwards. So that's how much people love you.
Thank you.
National treasure, our own Steve Poltz. We lost him to Nashville a few years ago, but he always comes home for tacos and surfing.
I'm here for 3 weeks.
Wow.
Are you?
That's a good stretch.
Yeah.
Good for you.
Busman's holiday, because I play tomorrow night. And then, isn't Busman's holiday a great term?
What
Do you
is
know
that?
What that means?
No. I don't.
It's like when a bus driver goes on holiday and still drives. I came here to go to the beach, and I was like, why not play a show, bro?
Well,
remember in Fast Times at Ridgemont High? I figure if it's your time and my time, doesn't that make it our time? There's nothing wrong with a little pizza on our time. Is there, Mr. Han?
Mr. Han.
I read the book, man.
Mr. Han.
Why would you read Ernest Hemingway when you could read Fast Times at Ridgemont High?
Great.
That's real literature. Right?
You dick.
Oh, Macaulay.
Yes.
I know you are a great positive influence, and you believe in spirit of creation.
Yep.
If I were to say, I need a Steve Poltz t-shirt that features you writing a giant taco carried by ants. Could you make that happen for me?
I could get you one. I have them here. I just got them printed out. You know what's cool? I know all these different artists, and now they just listen when I call them. They're friends of mine. And I know this girl. She's in Vashon Island off of Seattle. Mm-hmm. And I called her up, and I go, you're the perfect person for this. And I said, can you do a T-shirt of me riding a taco being carried by ants? And she said, I'm not even going to question this because it's you. And then we got the T-shirts just made, and I brought them out. They're cool.
I like it. And it's got that kind of like 1971 Keep On Truckin' font. It says Steve Poltz, and he's riding a giant taco. And there are two giant ants holding him up as their savior. They're welcoming the savior into town. It's almost like Palm Sunday. You're riding in on a giant taco. And that's the latest in Steve Poltz fashion wear, isn't it?
It is.
I like it.
And we sold out instantly, so we just got a bunch more printed up. I couldn't believe how popular they
were. That's crazy.
Yeah.
You've had a lot going on these days. I saw, we were just talking about guitars a minute ago here. I saw you at the, was it the Martin Factory? You were playing at like a 1937 Martin guitar.
Oh my God. I was in Carter Vintage Guitars in Nashville, Tennessee, and they have a special room. It's like the room off to the side where people like Vince Gill and stuff sell back old guitars or buy them. And you go in that room and they just kind of look at you weird, like, you're wearing a belt? Because they don't want the belt to scrape the back of the guitar if you're playing it, you know?
Gotcha.
Hand you a towel. And I picked up this one Martin, and I was playing it. It was so nice. It was like from 1940 or something. And then I said, wow, this is a beautiful guitar. And then it was like $38,000. They have some that are $120,000 guitars.
Did you have that on you at the time? Did you have $38,000 in cash on you?
I didn't. Mm. I wish I did. I had spent it.
Would they take an IOU?
I hope so. And a taco tea.
Payment plan?
A taco tea would be good. But then I got home, and my regular guitar, my Taylor guitar, my Smokey Joe that was given to me by Bob Taylor 20 years ago, he knew when I came in. He was like, I smell another guitar on it. And they know. They know.
Yes, they do.
They know.
They always know.
And I started looking really kind of sort of furtive with the sideways glance, and then Smokey Joe was like, no, I'll just be over here. That's cool. Uh-huh. And then I strummed Smokey, and the G string broke. I was like, deal with that, punk.
Wow.
Bitter.
I know. So Smokey's here. I didn't end up getting the other one. They know.
Are y'all made up now?
Everything's okay? Yeah. Oh, reunited.
Like, now this guitar, Smokey Joe, this is a famous guitar. You'll see this when you go see Steve play. Has it's got some battle scars on it. You've got a thumb hole worn into it.
It's been lost in so many airports, and sometimes it hangs out with other guitars. It's kind of like that Tom Robbins novel, Skinny Legs and All, where there's a can of beans, and there's a sock from a construction worker and a spoon that was in a convent. Oh. And they all are going to the Middle East to make peace together, and they take on a form of life. Tom Robbins writes this great book called Skinny Legs and All. And so inanimate objects actually do have feelings.
Yeah.
And they know. And this guitar knows.
Oh, yeah.
And it's so loyal to me. I have other guitars at home, and they always look, and they know Smokey Joe's the only one going. And other people can't believe touring artists, they bring like 10 guitars. Mm-hmm. They always go, you just bring one? And I go, yep. They go, what if it breaks? I go, then I get it fixed, or then I'll have to borrow some other guitar, but I just bring one guitar. I have a streak going of bringing this one guitar.
Does Smokey Joe get irritated about being thrown into baggage when you're traveling up? I mean, maybe buy a ticket for it or bring it with you on board the plane, overhead compartment?
Here's the deal.
Yeah.
Let me tell you, here's the deal. I always carry Smokey Joe on in that case because Southwest does big cabbage compartments.
Yeah.
Cabbage?
Baggage.
Baggage.
Yes.
Baggage.
If you bring cabbage.
We smoke our cabbage. Just like Louis Armstrong, smoking cabbage. I've been smoking cabbage all morning, bro. I went to the store. I thought it was the Apple store, but it was the weed store. It was MedMen. And so they have baggage. And if you're A-list, which I am because I fly a lot and I have a companion pass, then you board first and the guitar always just goes right up and they're cool about it. However, a lot of times I have to fly in to play weird little gigs in places like Vail or somewhere. Mm-hmm. And then you have to take like American or United or Delta. And then I bring the hard case, but I carry it through baggage and then I play dumb and I go, oh, I can't bring this on because they don't have enough, and then it gets hand carried below, and you don't have to pay for the extra bag. Here's the deal, because you get two bags free usually, and so you don't want to pay for the third bag, and if you did check the guitar, they'd call it the third bag, but you need two big suitcases filled with merch, t-shirts of me riding on top of a taco, if you will. And so,
naturally.
And my cards for Steve Poltz, attorney for ducks, because I represent ducks out there that are being sued.
Damn ducks.
So what I do is I bring the guitar and then act dumb and go, oh. And then they go, that's okay. We'll hand carry it down to the gate. And I go, cool. And then you don't have to pay for it. It's a third bag. It's a little tricky.
Very smart.
Yeah. Or you get a golf bag because golfers make the rules in the world. Mm. I'm not a golfer, but I know one thing. Golfers make all the rules. They have the most money usually. And so what you do is you get a big golf bag from this company called Club Glove. Club Glove is like really good luggage and it's guaranteed for life. Their suitcases are like rectangular, so I can fit all my merch in that. Then I bring a big golf bag, and sometimes I'll bring two guitars, and I can fit them both in the golf bag. And then I go to check it in. I'll be in Australia or something. They go, where are you playing? I just go, Whispering Palms. Like, or wherever I'm playing some show, I just make up a name. And the guitars go in together because you will get charged for two extra guitars. But if you're a golfer, they go, that's okay. But if you had a big bass guitar, they charge you for oversized. But a big golf bag, they don't, because golfers make all the rules in the world. Once you make peace with this, it's fine. I don't even golf, nor do I argue with golfers. All I know is, how do golfers get away with all this stuff? Okay, I'll just act like a golfer. I don't look like a golfer, but I'll do it.
You're a pretty clever fellow, Steve.
Yes, you are.
Yes, you are. So this hole that you have in Smokey Joe, is that damage or is that just years of...
That's years of my fingers.
Enthusiastic playing, right?
Yeah.
How about years that? Doesn't Willie have a guitar like that too that he's worn a hole in? Is it Willie that I'm thinking of?
Willie's guitar is called Trigger, and it's amazing.
Does he have a hole in his guitar?
Oh,
I'm thinking
hole.
Of someone's. Yeah.
Huge hole.
And that doesn't hurt the sound of it?
Not as far as we know.
Okay. I never thought about that, Dick.
What do you mean sound?
I don't know, putty over it or something like that. No, that's all part of the experience, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. You so, and Smokey Joe.
Being here today, it just means so much to me because of that. We were locked in all year.
Yeah.
And it was weird being in downtown Nashville. I would go downtown Nashville sometimes to get something. And my friend, you know Nancaro, Graham Nancaro? Mm-hmm. He lives there.
His dad was Lauren then. Relative of Lauren's family?
It was his son.
Okay, I know them. They're a nice family.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But Lauren passed away, as you know, as did our other good friend, Larry Himmel.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so I went downtown to see Graham Nancaro, and I was downtown Nashville, and you wouldn't even know there was a pandemic.
Really?
Like, and then you came here, and you would know there was a pandemic. And so I don't know, man. Now it looks like I got vaccinated back in January. Don't tell anyone, but I found a loophole, as I did with baggage.
Mm-hmm.
I found out if you live in Nashville and you drive 5.5 hours south to Andalusia, Alabama, because I'm on the border of Alabama, you know, kind of close. Mm-hmm. And so I went down to Alabama because there's like a bunch of people that don't want to get the vaccine in Alabama. And it was easy, and they always had 20 extras. So I went down and got the Moderna vaccine because I'm into mid-century modern architecture.
Uh-huh.
And so, like, as far as me, I want everything mid-century.
Right.
So I demanded to get that. They tried to give me Pfizer, and I was like, no way, bro. I'm into mid-century. And what's cool, a lot of people are telling you, like, there's people that freak out that say there's a microchip and you're being tracked.
Yeah.
And I'm here to tell you there is a microchip and I know it and I asked for it and Bill Gates did give me it. And but I got songwriter microchip when I got the vaccine. So as I've been sitting here, I've already written 3 songs due to that chip.
Damn.
And I just ordered more coffee delivered, meth coffee, over from Starbucks. So I'm able to do so many things right now.
It's incredible.
It's superhuman.
Incredible.
It's no wonder you're in the Hall of Fame. You know, Steve is playing Sundown Sessions. He's going to be at Tower Beach Club on Friday night. Our Sarah was so excited. She bought tickets for her and all her friends.
All of them.
All her girlfriends.
Yeah.
All 6 of these Hoochie Mamas are coming out to hang out. This intimate, serene setting on the water for a Sunset Mission Beach show. And we're going to hear more from the great and the newest member of the Hall of Fame.
Woohoo!
Our dear friend Steve Poltz is with us. And we'll hear from the Chainsaw as well.
Yes!
It's all coming up this hour for you here on the KGB.
Home of the DSC.
I'm on the webpage, sundownsessionslive.com. Look at this yet, Emily?
Yeah.
Sundownsessionslive.com, and look who's on the front page. What? Sitting there with his guitar, looking all rock and roll. Mr. Steve Poltz, our dear friend, the Hall of Famer, who's our guest here in studio. And we just had a nice discussion about afterbirth and placentas and stuff, didn't we, Steve? What did you think about that? You get these women together. We have Anna. Anna has just enjoyed her introduction with Steve Poltz. Mm-hmm. They just met each other for the first time. And we got talking about placentas and all kinds of things. What did you think about that?
Me? It was amazing because I didn't know we were going to be doing placenta talk.
Nor did I.
I wasn't. When I woke up driving down here, I thought we would talk about the Padres or something, but it quickly escalated to placenta talk. And both of Emily and
Anna
and Sarah were all talking about placentas. So it was crazy. Imagine. I don't know. Yeah. It's pretty weird. It got me thinking, though.
Is there a placenta song for the Sundown Sessions that we're going to see on Friday night, by the way? Doors are open at 6 o'clock. These tickets are almost sold out. You get yours while you still can at sundownsessionslive.com.
Tomorrow.
Yeah, is this a first-time performance for you here at this place?
Yeah, my friend Chris put it on, and what he did is he made it into like a little mini Humphreys thing at the Mission Bay Aquatic Center or something, the Tower Beach Club.
Yeah.
And he sets up all these chairs right on the water. And I play a show.
That's you, buddy.
At 7 p.m. And that's tomorrow. And we just added it. And so here I am out here. But then I didn't know we were going to talk placentas.
We don't have to.
I feel like we threw you off or something. I'm sorry.
No, it was great because it reminded me of a time when I was in South Australia and I was going back to Adelaide. And this woman with dreadlocks asked if I would play a benefit show for a birthing center. And it was like to keep it legal because she had all these legal bills because she was illegally having births take place at this place in Australia. And so when she picked me up, she brought me back and I didn't really know what I'd said yes to. And then I was backstage and she said, "What would you like to drink?" And I was like, "Just a cup of tea." So she made me a cup of tea. And then I said, "Do you have any milk?" And I went to get it out of the fridge. Uh-oh. She said, "Not that. That's the breast milk." Mm-hmm. And I go, "What do you mean the breast milk?" She goes, "Didn't you understand you're playing a birthing center?" And I said, "No." And then I went to grab something else. And she said, "Don't grab that. Those are frozen placentas.
Yeah.
A lot of the ladies eat them after birth because they eat them because it's like a good source of, I don't know, vitamin D or something."
Yeah.
And so I put the placenta back, and then they said, "Here's your lasagna." And then when they handed me it, before I went on stage, because I had said, "I guess I'll have lasagna," I go, "Are you sure it's not plasagna?" And that was kind of weird. So I got up on stage, and you know when you walk out on stage, sometimes you don't really look at the audience at first, and the bright lights were on me, and the whole front row was 30 women, but they were all breastfeeding, and they all had babies breastfeeding. And so I opened my eyes and I started playing and it freaked me out. And so I stopped the chord and I go, "This is awesome." Like that. I actually said that because my gatekeeper was asleep. And then this girl in the back goes, "Are you going to play You Were Meant For Me? I love You Were Meant For Me, mate." And so I do a terrible Australian accent. She goes, "This is going to be very good." So I said,
"That's not Australian."
No, I know.
That's like Australian.
She's like, "Is it safe?" So she comes up on, I go, "Do you know how to play it?" And she says, "Yeah." And I said, "Well, why don't you play it?" But she's breastfeeding her baby. Mm-hmm. So I go, "When you're done breastfeeding," she goes, "I play it now." And so she hands the baby to the woman next to her and puts it on that woman's breast because that woman had a spare breast.
Gosh.
And so I was like a lifeguard. And from the stage, I go, "You can't do that." And then she goes, "Haven't you ever heard of a wet nurse?" Which is like a thing where rich ladies would have somebody else do the breastfeeding for them.
Right.
And so I said, "Oh." And so she comes up topless and grabs Smokey Joe. And her breast was resting here, and milk was still a little bit leaking out on my guitar. And so I went to sit down. It was like 120 degrees because it's South Australia in the middle of our winter, which is their summer. And so I'm sitting there watching this happen, and this guy comes in, he's selling these chocolate cake treats. Uh-huh. So I grabbed two, and I hadn't eaten because the lasagna thing grossed me out. So I'm holding the chocolate, and it drips on my crotch, right on my crotch. So I have all this chocolate. So I get up in the middle of her song singing "You Were Meant For Me" to me with breast milk on Smokey Joe, and I go into the bathroom, but I don't shut the door all the way, like it was kind of creaked open. And I grab white toilet paper, and I'm wiping the chocolate off of my crotch like this. And there's three girls waiting to use the loo, and they don't know. So I grab it, and I go, well, I can still eat the chocolate. So they push the door open, and I'm going like this. I'm licking, and it looks like I'm licking poo. And, and they go, oh, my God, he's eating his own poo. So I go, well, you eat your own placenta. And then I had to go do the gig. So that got me thinking when you guys mentioned it. I'm sorry. Have we gone too far?
Not at all.
That might be my new favorite Steve Poltz story.
Yep.
Oh, my God. You started it.
Emily.
You eat your own poo. And I was playing. I saw them going, he eats his own poo. On stage.
Did that get performed that night? He eats his own poo? Because you write songs on the spot.
Oh, yeah.
I know you.
Of course it did.
That's incredible.
How's the guitar sound?
Everything sounds great.
Mm-hmm. Is it too loud?
You got the Australian breast milk off it?
Yeah.
Okay. No, I think that would have enhanced the wood.
All right. It did.
Yeah.
Damn it.
So I hope I see you guys tomorrow night.
That's
going to be right on the water.
Of course. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's going to be cool. Man, I think I'm going to open with this song. I'll do that. Like, you don't have to go now. In fact, don't go.
That's backwards.
We're uninvited now.
I don't. If I hear any listeners show up, I'll kick you out. It's like the anti-sales pitch.
Who here is from DSC? Out.
Get out now.
I like it.
Is that too distorted or is that good?
No, it's great.
You're about to watch a show starring me. I don't know what you're about to hear or see. The truth is I have no plan at all. There's a good chance that off this stage I'll fall. My body ain't quite what it used to be. My hair ain't the color it once was. My style icon is Emmy Lou Harris, mixed with a little Don Was. I lie on stage, I lie in songs, I lay my troubles down. Hey, stick it out with me, kid, I mean, what else is there to do in this godforsaken deep-fried bacon town? Yeah, you bought the tickets, you paid the cash, you got in the car, you moved your ass. You brought a friend or an awkward date to something you love that they're probably gonna hate. It's music, sweet music. I'm emo, I'm screamo, I'm country, and I'm folk Americana. If you wanna, I'm old-fashioned, but I'm woke. I'm everything to everyone, I'm Jesus, and I'm Buddha too. Don't panic, I'm organic, I'm too scared to be satanic. But mostly I'm just here to sing for you. Well, I've played a lot of shows across this world, but tonight's the best I'll ever play. I'm handing you a pearl. My G-string might snap in two. My face might turn from red to white to blue. But it's not because I'm dying, hey, I'm just patriotic. Where we all connect like Legos, yeah, we all are symbiotic. I die on stage, I die in songs, I lay my troubles down. Hey, stick it out with me, kid, I mean, what else is there to do in this craft beer making earthquake shaking town? Yeah, you bought the tickets, you paid the cash, you got in the car, you moved your ass. You brought a friend or an awkward date to something you love that they're definitely gonna hate. It's music, sweet music. I'm emo, I'm screamo, I'm Grateful Dead post-stroke. Americana if you wanna, I'm old-fashioned but I'm broke. I'm everything to everyone, I'm Jesus and I'm Buddha too. Don't panic, I'm organic, I'm too scared to be satanic. But mostly I'm just here to sing for you. Well, I know what you're thinking, what the hell? This guy just wrote a whole entire song about himself. And the truth is, I do it all the time. Well, for me, it's therapeutic, and I hope that you don't mind.
Well, I probably owe you money, cause you're my therapist. But I'm kinda like your escort away from all of this. I'd cry on stage, I cry in songs, I try to work it out. Hey, stick it out with me, kid, I mean, what else is there to do? And this hemp clothes making, tincture taking, sardo baking, late day waking, spare change taking, traffic making, release the kraken. I must be mistaken, I'm in the wrong town.
Look at him. Man, you are playing on that one. You shred. You shred, buddy. What is that called?
That's called Wrong Town.
I like it.
That'll be on my upcoming album.
Another album coming out. Look at you. All right, can I beg one more? Can I beg one more segment out of you?
Yeah, I'd love to. I'll be here till 5 p.m.
Great.
I will not.
I'm going to be like that guy that stays under the desk in Seinfeld. What's his name? He wouldn't get out.
George Costanza.
Yeah.
All right, Steve is playing tomorrow night what we call the Sundown Sessions Live. It's going to be the Tower Beach Club. And I can't believe that there are tickets still left. This guy always sells out. So we know it's going to happen again. I wouldn't wait. Get those tickets now at sundownsessionslive.com. Steve says they put the seats right out there by the water. That sounds like his kind of show. You can see more at sundownsessionslive.com, and we've got another segment coming up with our good friend, the great Steve Poltz, here on KGB.
Hey Siri, remind me to watch.
I'm going to remind you. The Steve Poltz Show tomorrow night, the Sundown Sessions at Tower Beach Club, where you enjoy an intimate and serene setting on the water as the sun sets in Mission Beach. The doors are open at 6 o'clock and Steve starts playing at 7. And these tickets are just about sold out. In fact, I'll give you some tickets before we finish up our visit with Steve Poltz today here. But still time to get your tickets when you go to the website sundownsessionslive.com. SundownSessionsLive.com.
Now, your chance to win a trip to our iHeartRadio Music Festival. Text nationwide keyword festival to 200-200. You'll get a confirmation text and info. Standard data and message rates apply in this nationwide contest. That's festival to 200-200.
Hey, thanks for switching us on. It's Thursday morning with the DSC Radio Show and your favorite guest of all time, Steve Poltz. In a 10-listener poll, 10 out of 10, Steve Poltz. They love him.
Yes,
we all love him. Put you in a good mood, you know?
He does.
Positive guy. Mm-hmm. Nobody ever walked out of a Steve Poltz show with a frown on.
No.
Everybody feels good. Steve Poltz and Smokey Joe at the Sundown Sessions Live tomorrow night. Well, Steve, you and I were talking during the commercial break there. Will there be any kind of celebration for your dad's life when you perform tomorrow night? I know your dad has gone on to his great reward, and I was sorry to see that, and you're dealing with that kind of stuff. But what a guy. What a hell of a guy your dad was, right?
He was such a good guy, man. And he died in November. But, you know, I gotta be grateful because he made it to 90 and his mind was sharp to the very end. And he looked at me and just like, we just always had fun. We loved watching baseball together.
Right.
And he was a Dodgers guy because we had immigrated from Canada to Los Angeles when I was a little kid. And when the Dodgers won the World Series last year, he actually said to me, I can die now.
Oh.
Like he was very and he missed my mom. She'd been gone 2 years. So he got sick all of a sudden, and I was out at Jewel's house in Telluride, and we were writing songs, and I got a call, your dad was just rushed to the hospital. And I just had lunch with him,
And I was going to see him because I lived out here in San Diego. I rented a little place at Wind and Sea, and I was seeing him every other day. And so I'd go have lunch. I'd sneak him out of the place. We were in the middle of the pandemic. Mm-hmm. And so I'd have to, like, bust him out with two other, like, 90-year-old ladies. And we'd go have lunch. And it was amazing. Mm. And so I got to spend so much time with him. And he was a poet and just the most gentle soul. And I'll tell you what, man. I was with him. We brought him home. And when you're in hospice, makes you the hospice nurse, basically. They give you all the morphine and Ativan. And I was just by his side, and I just remember, you know, it was slowly fading away. And I looked at him, and he looked at me, and he goes, "We sure had some fun, didn't we?"
Oh, that's nice. Great and memories.
So it was like Thanksgiving. And my buddy Matt, who's in the room right now, he was like, "Hey, you guys, it's Thanksgiving. I'll bring you over a big turkey dinner." So he brought us over food from, he left his own Thanksgiving dinner and brought it over. And my dad would recite Shakespeare. He memorized all the sonnets because in Canada they would make him do it. And so he memorized all the Shakespearean sonnets. And so we're there and he's like close to death and he sits up in the bed to shake Matt's hand. And Matt's pretty big, but my dad was sort of hallucinating. And he says, my dad goes, "Are you a sumo wrestler?" So he shakes his hand. And then he goes, "Let me tell you a Shakespearean sonnet." And then he recites a Shakespearean sonnet to him. And he lays back down and Matt has to go. I hug Matt goodbye. And the next morning, like, my dad's close to death.
Yeah.
And he goes, "Come here. Come here." And I go, "What?" He goes, "Closer. Closer. I can't talk loud." And I think he's going to tell me he loves me. And he goes, "Tell that sumo wrestler it wasn't Shakespeare. I made a mistake. It was to La Costa, Going to the War by Richard Lovelace." And then he goes, "I still got it, Stephen Boy." His last words to me.
That's awesome.
And then he was gone. Like, he was concerned. He was Canadian to the very end. Like, there's this cartoon that's one of my favorite. It says, Mexican standoff. It shows two guys with guns waiting to shoot each other. And then below it says, Canadian standoff. And it's a guy holding a door open for the other guy going, "No, you go. No, you go. No, you go." And so, it was,
well,
like,
bless his heart.
Yeah, so he left. And he left the mortal coil. And he was gone like that. But I just have really good memories of him.
Terrific. That's terrific.
So I wouldn't have been able to be doing what I'm doing because my dad always said to me, "Life's too long to not do what you want to do. I hated my job. I always wanted to be a teacher. I should have been a teacher. Don't do a job unless it's what you really want to do." And he would say that to me. So here I am. I'm the newest member of DSC. I'm going to be here every day, and this is the announcement we're making.
All right.
It's so cool.
So be it.
DSCP.
All right.
DSCP.
Your dad sounds like Aces, quality
Poltz.
Guy. I like his advice. That's great advice.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah.
I know.
What do you suppose he would have taught? The arts? Something like that?
He
literature?
Would have taught literature.
Yeah.
Yeah, poetry, English. And it was, you know, it was a different time back then.
Yeah.
And he was in the Royal Air Force, Royal Canadian Air Force.
Was he?
Yeah.
What did he do?
And he was a radio man.
Right on.
And I just got a letter from the Canadian government thanking, you know, saying, "Your dad, we want to thank him for his service to Canada," and blah, 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 all this really nice stuff. And I didn't see it till today because I'd rented this little apartment at Winnensea, and I just opened it before I came in, and I had a little cry before I came down here. But it's a good cry.
Yeah.
You know,
what
tear
a nice
up?
Honor from the Royal Canadian Air Force to do that for him.
It
That's
was
a nice
really
touch.
Really nice touch. Yeah. And Sharon goes, "That is so Canadian." Polite to the very end.
Polite.
They're so polite in Canada. You could bump into somebody at an ATM and just walk by and bump into them, and they'll go, "Sorry." They'll say it to you. Yeah, you bumped into them.
Well, that's very nice, isn't it?
Yeah. So being in here and being able to come in and sing for you guys has always been so much fun. And my friend Matt drove me in here. And, you know,
Thank you, Matt.
The guy during the pandemic that kept saying, "You know, why don't you write a pandemic song?" He would always say it when we go on walks.
Like that?
He takes me seriously.
Did he start talking like that?
It was like,
almost
he would nag at me.
Nagging you.
And I got so mad at him, and I was like, "Why don't you write one if it's so easy?" And then it kind of scared him. You know, you sometimes snap at your friend. And then I felt guilty because I'm Catholic, and I sat back down. I'm Catholic and Canadian, double guilt. Pack your bags, we're going on a guilt trip. So I pulled out the guitar, and I was like, I baked 100 loaves of bread, I fell down on my head. I vacuumed till I sweated, ate food that I regretted. I sat near the fire wearing questionable attire. I made a new incision to improve my circumcision. Oh yeah. My hair's unruly and I learned to make the booty. It felt kinda groovy, watched every single movie. You know I've been depressed, I never even got dressed. I was feeling full of pity, so I joined a subcommittee. I learned the word abrogation, tried to find a new vocation, searched the whole skyscraper, tried to steal some toilet paper, made a bong out of a peach, I learned to brush my teeth with bleach, prayed for a vaccine, I learned about hydroxychloroquine, yeah. I was sitting on the toilet trying to get some unemployment, I stayed in the bathroom for a meeting on Zoom, forgot I wasn't wearing pants, did a little dance, I was jiggling down below and everybody got a free show. Jeffrey Toobin, I want my sleeve on my heart. I found a new body part. I learned about zinc sulfate and how to meditate. Was naked in a cape. I learned to do some manscape. I lost a little bit of blood, but I still felt like a stud. I high-fived a little kid. I thought I got COVID. Listen to Jerry Garcia, made my own tortillas. Found a new cake mix. I checked my body for ticks. Got run over by a bus and a tornado almost killed us. Oh yeah. I became unemployed, started getting paranoid. I was eating a burrito and got bit by a mosquito. Grew a garden full of cherry, I got cauliflower here. Read all of Macbeth and I learned how to cook meth. I drew my curtain shut, I was acting like a nut. I've been growing out my stubble, I've been living in a bubble. Everything was unbearable, started feeling terrible. Thought I should buy a gun, instead I got a man bun. I got to get some social distance to help with my existence. Need some logical assistance to a path of least resistance. Feeling undesirous and no one wants to hire us. Learned every song by Miley Cyrus and all about coronavirus. I'm a midnight lurker, I'm a least essential worker. You don't even have to ask, I'll use my undies for a mask. You know I understand, I gotta wash my hands. Might have worms, but I don't have demon sperms. I got a stimulus check, but I feel like a wreck. I've become a decent cook, I read every single book. I might blast off, but I cover my cough. My pants are getting baggy and I'm looking kinda shaggy. I'm a king of innuendo, I can make a big crescendo. You know I cut my hair, man, I just don't care. Maybe I should join the Navy, I should give myself a shave. Accidentally got a COVID kiss, I think I need an exorcist. Help! I don't really want a butter, but I'm feeling like a shot. And I've been sweating in my body and I'm looking kinda snotty. Need a nurse, I'm supposed to shove a Q-tip up my nose. Getting kinda grouchy, I'm in love with Dr. Fauci. I guess I could steal a tank or maybe go around a bank and watch my arteries harden until I get a pot. I don't need to wear shoes, guess I'll hit snooze. I was born to clues, I got the quarantine blues. I got the quarantine blues. Let me out of the house. Let's go full capacity, baby. I got it. DSC Poltz show. DSC B. Quack, quack, quack.
There it is.
Wow. Maniac. Complete maniac. He should be institutionalized. How's he not in handcuffs? This guy should be in handcuffs. Leg restraints, something, everything, the whole thing. We love him to death.
Yes.
And you will too when you go see him at the Sundown Sessions tomorrow night, Friday night. And this is very exciting. We don't know when it's going to happen. Could be tonight. Who knows? He's going to be singing at Petco Park for the Padres, which he should do every night.
Yes.
Turn this ship around and get the luck back going for the Padres.
I just got a text.
Tell me.
They were only supposed to sell 150 tickets to the show, but he's at 180, and he goes, I'm going to just set up 20 more chairs.
Good.
All right.
Pack them in. Why not? Because they went full capacity.
Sweet.
The most they could fit in, so they just added 20 more tickets because they're moving crazy.
Well, you could add another show. That's really
so fun.
You should add another show.
And I want to say, I'm going to do my own music festival in Joshua Tree. October 1st and 2nd.
Is that true? You're going
to
do that?
Uh-huh, because the guy gave me the Joshua Tree Music Festival site to have my own thing, because my dad, every time he coughed, he'd go,
Bahutensy.
And it's a word he made up called Bahutensy.
And
I guess, I don't know what it means. I'm going to just say many blessings to you.
Bahutensy.
That's so I'm calling the festival Bahutensy. It's going to be a folk fest. I know.
I love that.
And I'll also be back in San Diego February 18th and 19th to play the Belly Up two nights for the annual thing. So
the birthday party.
I need to buy a house in San Diego.
Yeah, I do.
Women's seat.
That's what I want one.
We need to change Wind and Sea to Pahootensee.
Yeah.
Man, thank you so much. God bless the DSC show. You guys are the best.
You are.
This is the best segment ever I've ever been on. Any radio I've ever done anywhere. This is the greatest day I've ever had.
All right, quick timeout. And Emily's going to tell you everything that's happening in the world next here on the KGB.